out tonight. Good to be in the house of the Lord, and appreciate you coming out on this Wednesday evening. Let's stand. We'll sing a couple of songs tonight, and you're stuck with me again tonight. Page 581, if you need a hymn book, 'Tis So Sweet to Trust in Jesus. I need thee, oh, I need thee. Every hour I need thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to thee. Amen. You may be seated. Good singing. It's a wonderful song. Great truth there. I need him every hour. We need him all the time. There's no doubt about it. We're going to go to the Lord in prayer. I want to mention a few things to pray about. And then tonight we will give you an opportunity if you'd like to mention some prayer requests. We won't pass the mic around tonight, but so you'll have to just speak up. But let's remember our young people as they head out on Friday for the teen retreat. Pray the Lord will give them a good time there and bless them. Pray for the workers as well. And just pray for safety and everything goes well and there's no issues there. So remember them in prayer. I know they covet our prayers. And let's remember our young people and pray the Lord will send the right person here for us as far as a youth pastor, assistant pastor is concerned. And we need a right man to come along, and you just pray the Lord give us wisdom, and it would be nice to have contacts too. You know, we've had a few, but just pray that the Lord will send somebody our way. And I got a man I'm talking to, and just talked with him for about an hour this past week, and probably talk with him again, so you just pray. If that's the Lord's will, we'll know and be able to determine that. But remember that in prayer. Also, let's continue to pray for our church. I thought we had a good kickoff to our life groups with the teen life groups. And let's continue to pray as we'll highlight a life group each Sunday and just pray that it'll grow from that. And there's you walk around the educational building and there are empty classrooms. And there needs to be teachers there, and there needs to be someone teaching a life group. And so pray from this that maybe even some of them will be able to sort of divide up, and we'll have more opportunities there to be together. And so pray for that. Pray for our new members class or the Love 101 we're going to go through coming up in February. And you just pray for that. I have several that are interested and been talking with different couples about joining the church, and it's been great and good to see. So thankful the Lord's moving, you know. So it's a wonderful thing. So let's remember that. And, of course, our maybe on Wednesday nights in the future, we'll have a missionary that we'll highlight that we can pray for besides the one that we do in our life groups. And so we can be reminded of that. Not, you know, we don't need to get stale on missions. That's the heartbeat of God. And we need to have that always before us. So we'll try to do that in the future, but let's remember our missionaries, and we will be emphasizing that the month of March, Lord willing, and at the end of March, I don't know the exact date, but the last Sunday in March, Brother Dean Hamby will be with us. The church has supported Brother Hamby for a long time, and I've known him for a long time. He's a great man of God. I'm looking forward to having him be with us, and so he'll be with us at the end of March. And then let me give you just a few updates. Gail Mask is doing well, and the surgery went well, and she was supposed to be coming home this afternoon the last time I talked to him. Continue to pray for Brother Ed Mays. He's got a long recovery as far as taking antibiotics and things like that for his knee, and remember him. Of course, Herman and Maggie. Herman had double pneumonia. Now Maggie's sick, so remember them in prayer as well. Brother William requested prayer this morning. Remember him. He goes tomorrow to see what they can do for his cancer, a different type of treatment. So the last one wasn't working. So remember him in prayer. And of course, special way. All right, Brother Bobby, do you mind leading us in prayer, and we'll all pray. Amen. Amen. All right, let's take the Word of God tonight, if you would. And we're going back to the book of Hebrews. Back to the book of Hebrews. And tonight we're going to chapter number 12. Hebrews chapter number 12 this evening. Hebrews chapter 12, we'll look and begin in verse number 1. Hebrews chapter 12, verse number 1. Wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which does so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. We've been looking at these commands given in the book of Hebrews that begin with that phrase, let us. And we begin all the way back in chapter 4, I believe it was, and there's several of these mentioned. And our last time together, we were in chapter 10, and if you remember, we were in the throne room. And he says, let us draw near. And so the next command comes in chapter 12. So in a sense, we're still in that throne room. We're still with our Father, and we've been brought close to Him, and now another command comes. And we have it here in verse 1. Look at it again, please. He says, wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, here it is, let us lay aside. Let us lay aside. Now, last time together, we seen the greatest privilege we have as believers, and that is being with the Lord Jesus and being in that throne room and drawing near to Him. Now He's going to give us how to live the Christian life. Just simple things. Simple things. Two things that He gives, two commands He gives here on how to live the Christian life. And it's almost like He's whispering to our ear as we're in the throne room, here's what you need to do. First of all, lay aside. Lay aside. Now that word lay aside, it means to place down. It has the idea to put something in the opposite direction that you're going. If you lay something aside, you're not going to fool with it. You're not going to mess with it. And he's saying here, you need to lay aside. Lay aside. Now, before we get into what we are to lay aside, there's some encouragement that he gives in this. I think it's interesting. Look back at the beginning of the verse in verse number 1. And here's a word that when we see this word, we have to explore. He says, wherefore? So there's a reasoning he's saying that. He's referring back to something he's already said. Wherefore, see. He said, you need to look to them and realize that you can do it as well. That cloud of witnesses is an encouragement. Look in the over in chapter 11, since we're there. Look in verse, starting verse 32. He stops with Rahab in verse 31, and then he begins to just list several. Look in verse 32. And he said, what shall I more say? For the time would fail me to tell of Gideon, of Barak, of Samson, of Japheth, of David also, and of Samuel, and of the prophets, who through faith subdued kingdoms, wrought righteousness, obtained promises, stopped the mouths of lions, that's talking about Daniel, quenched the violence of fire, the three Hebrew children, escaped the edge of the sword, out of weakness were made strong, waxed valiant in fight, turned to flight the armies of the aliens, women received their dead raised to life again, and others were tortured, not accepting deliverance that they might obtain a better resurrection. And others had trial of cruel mockings and scourgings, yea, moreover, of bonds and imprisonment. They were stoned, they were sawn asunder, were tempted, were slain with the sword. They wandered about in sheepskins and goatskins, talking about John the Baptist, being destitute, afflicted, tormented. That doesn't sound like a group you want to be a part of, does it? Honestly, nobody wants to go through those things. Look in verse 38. I love this verse. Of whom the world was not worthy. The world wasn't worthy of them. They wandered in deserts and in mountains and in dens and caves of the earth. And these all, having obtained a good report through faith, received not the promise. God having provided some better things for us, that they without us should not be made perfect. What is he saying here in these verses? He's saying we have a great cloud of witnesses we're to look to. Though they're there for an encouragement, they're there for just a moment, but he's saying also here that, listen, we have to continue on because we complete them. Without us, they cannot be made perfect. You know, they live the Christian life, and listen, we have to continue this thing on. We have to continue this battle for the faith, living by faith. He's saying, listen, you have to continue it. He says, wherefore, seeing all this, seeing this cloud of witnesses, looking back at all those who gave themselves for the cause of Christ, here's what he says you need to do. Lay aside. Now, what do we lay aside? There's two things here. Look what he says. Two things that we're supposed to lay aside. He says, let us lay aside every weight. Every weight. Now, what is weight? You know, I looked the word up. I mean, you'd think I ought to know what it means because I carry a lot of it. But the definition, listen to the definition of the word weight. It's the downward force of the body. Boy, that sounds a lot better, don't it? You know, that sounds a lot, it sounds a lot better. I have a lot more downward force than some people. You know, that sounds better, you know. But that's what it means. So think about it now. Think about that word, a downward force of the body. It also means, the word weight also means burden. Burden. Now notice that this is a weight. He says, lay aside the weight. He's not saying it's sin. The weight is not sin. But it's something that puts a downward force upon us that keeps us from being able to run the race like we need to run it. So now, he does not mention, he just says, every weight. You say, well, what is the weight? What is it in my life? Listen, that's between you and the Lord. You have to figure that out. What, you know, there's things that could hinder me in my walk with the Lord Jesus that would not hinder you, and vice versa. We all have certain weights that bother us, that keep us from doing what we need to do. And he's saying here, let us lay these weights aside. Let us lay these burdens. You know, many times when you see burdens in the Bible, it talks about casting them or placing them on the Lord Jesus. You know, it's a good thing to have a burden. We should have a burden for things. We say the word, well, I have a burden for lost people. That is wonderful. We should have a burden. But if you have a true burden, a true burden will cause you to lose sleep. It will cause you not to eat. A true burden in your life will consume you. That's why he says you've got to cast it on him, because we can't handle it. We can't handle a burden. And listen, if we're going to do what we're supposed to do in the Christian life, we have to lay aside the weight. Because here, weight is not sin, but weight can cause sin. It's not sin, but it can cause it. For instance, everybody knows the story of Lot, Abraham and Lot. Remember, they had gotten so big, their possessions and their cattle and their servants and all that Abraham realized there's strife here, and Abraham didn't want it. So remember, he called Lot and he said, listen, you whatever way you go, I'll go the opposite. I don't want no strife. You pick whichever side you want to go to, what land you want, you pick it. And remember, he looked towards Sodom and he saw the well-watered plains of Sodom. Now, there was nothing wrong with him wanting those well-watered plains for his cattle. That was not sin. But unfortunately, that became a weight, because it got him close to Sodom. And of course, we know the rest of the story. It led to great sin in Lot's life. It's not sin, but it can lead to sin. And that's why he's saying, listen, you need to just lay that aside. That's not easy. That's not easy. But if we want to run the race, we got to get rid of that downward force that is on our body. We got to get rid of that weight. Not only weight, but notice what he says to lay aside. He says, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which does so easily beset us. So we lay aside every weight and the sin. Now, notice he doesn't say sins. Interesting thing about this passage, he's talking about one sin, one particular sin. Now, we read this and we think, well, he's talking about the sin in my life. No, he's talking about one sin in particular. Notice the definite article, the sin. So what is the sin that I need to lay aside? Of course, he's not saying keep every other sin. We understand that. But what Paul is dealing, he's dealing with one certain thing. So what is that sin that I need to lay aside so that I can run the race? What is that sin? Well, in the context of Hebrews and in the context of this passage, I think we can find it. Look with me in Hebrews chapter 3. Look in Hebrews chapter 3 and verse number 12. I believe this is the sin he's talking about here that we need to lay aside. Hebrews chapter 3, verse number 12. He says, take heed, brethren, lest there be any of you an evil heart, here it is, unbelief. Unbelief. He spent a whole chapter in chapter 11 talking about faith, 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 faith. And then he comes to chapter 12 and he says, now, if you're going to run this race, you need to lay aside the weight, every weight, anything that's going to hinder you, get rid of it in your life. And then he said, and the sin, the one sin that'll keep you from running the race. What is it? Unbelief. Unbelief. We'll never move forward as believers if we don't believe. For without faith is it impossible to please him. The Christian life, everything in the Christian life is done by faith. Do you know that? Think about it. You were saved by faith. You were saved by faith. You live your life when you pray. Do you understand when you pray, that takes faith? Because you're talking to someone you cannot see. And you're talking to someone you cannot see because of a book that was written telling you to do it. What is that? That's faith. The Christian life is faith. It's always faith. And if we're going to run the race, we have to have faith. We have to lay aside that one sin, that sin of unbelief that creeps up in our hearts. And we all deal with it. Every believer deals with the sin of unbelief. I'm reminded of the man who came to the Lord Jesus, remember? And he said, "Lord, I believe, help thou mine unbelief." We all deal with it. We all deal with the fact of unbelief. And he's saying that sin of unbelief, you need to lay aside every weight, lay aside that. Why? Let's continue the verse. Why do we lay it aside? He says, because it besets us. Besets us. That word beset means to be pressed upon from every side. You know, you get something pressing against you, you don't move too well. It's got to be free of any weight, free of that sin. And if it's free, you can move. But if you're not, listen, he says it will beset. Doesn't mean you can't walk. It's just saying you can't do the race like God intended for you to do the race. And he said, listen, lay aside every weight. Lay aside the sin of unbelief that besets us. And then he gives the second command. He gives it here. Let us run with patience the race that is set before us. Let us run. Let us run. How do we run this race? What is this race? Well, he says, first of all, we run the race with patience. With patience. He didn't say you run the race with speed. I'm thankful for that. You know, all of us run at a different pace, you know. Some of us are faster than others. You know, I don't run unless I'm scared. That's the only time I've ever run in my life, when I get scared, you know. I remember growing up, I used to hang out with the preacher's kids, and I tell you, that's the worst kids to hang out with, is them preacher kids. You got to watch. I married a preacher's kid. You got to watch them preacher's kids. And they're only mean because they hang around deacon's kids, but that's, I grew up, you know, and I spent the night many times at my pastor's home, His son was my best friend. We was young, real young. And he had a farm. And we'd get out and play and explore, you know, out in the fields. And we crossed over. It wasn't his. We crossed over a fence we wasn't supposed to cross over. You know, fences are there for a reason, especially barbed wire fences. And so we crossed over that fence and was walking through the field. He remembered, my buddy there remembered, oh, there's a big bull in this fence. Yeah, we found out real quick because here he come a-running. And, you know, growing up, I always had a lot of downward force on my body when I was growing up. Don't that sound a lot better? That makes me feel better. But I had a lot of downward force on my body, and he was skinny. But that day, I outran him because I was scared. And we jumped the fence, and I still got the scar. I had to have stitches. I still got the scar where I grabbed hold of that barbed wire fence on the other side. So the Lord reminds me of that. Don't cross barriers you're not supposed to because you end up with scars. And I've got the scar to prove it, you know. But we all run differently. He's not talking about when he's saying run with patience. He's saying this, Run with endurance and consistency. He's not talking about being fast. He's not talking about you have to run a certain speed in this race. You know, it's interesting. Paul uses the games, you know. The Romans had their games just like we have their games. You know, I don't think it was called the Roman Bulldogs, but they had some kind of mascot, I'm sure. But they had their games. You've heard of the games, the Colosseums. The Romans were absolutely consumed with sports. The gladiators, all those things. They were consumed with it. It run their lives. Boy, that sounds familiar, don't it? With America nowadays. And they get so caught up in it. But Paul's used that. He knew they understood what it meant about running a race, because all of them had went to the races. They had seen them run their race and the marathons, you know. Anybody ever run a marathon? We had one run a marathon. I never run a marathon. I never would attempt. That's too long of a run for me. But, you know, how they got that, it was a Greek soldier who ran, I think it was from Carthage to another, I forget exactly where he ran, but it was the exact miles of a marathon. He ran that whole thing to let them know they had lost the battle, and he collapsed over dead. And that's why we have a marathon now. Pretty interesting, you know. But they understood the running of the games and all these things. And so Paul, for instance, 1 Corinthians 9:24, Paul uses this description again. He says, "Know ye not that they which run in a race run all, but one receiveth the prize? So run that ye may obtain." Paul said, listen, you don't run just to say you was in the race. Paul says, listen, you run to finish. You run, he said, you run to obtain, you know. Paul said, listen, what he was saying is you got to be serious about this thing. It's a race. Galatians 5:7, he uses it again. He says, ye did run well. Who did hinder you that you should not obey the truth? So Paul was using this analogy of the race, and he's saying, listen, if we're going to run this race, we got to lay aside every weight, that sin of unbelief. We run with patience, with endurance, with consistency. Then he says this, the race that is set before us. Not one that you choose, but the one God chooses. We don't know the race, only God knows the race. The race for all of us began at Calvary. That's the starting line. The race for all of us will end in glory one day. So all of us, we know our race begins at Calvary. It ends in glory. But listen, we don't know how long of a race that's going to be or how short of a race that's going to be. We don't know the curves. We don't know the valleys. We don't know the hills. God knows all that. But here's the thing. Your race is not someone else's race. Don't get the idea in the Christian life that you're the starting line and brother so-and-so's over here and brother so-and-so's on this side and you're just thinking, boy, if I can outrun them, I'm doing good. No, this race is not a competition with other brothers and sisters in Christ. This race is the will of God for your life, not their life. You're running to obtain because what He has for you. It's not a race against one another. It's not a race. Unfortunately, at times it seems like Christianity becomes a competition with people. You know? I remember, you know, I was reached, of course you know that, I was reached basically through the bus ministry. You know, but I can remember, you know, at times working the bus ministry, it'd be a big competition. Well, this church, they're giving away hot dogs. Well, this one, they're giving away hamburgers, or, you know, and it became almost like a competition. Well, they're going to swallow a goldfish down at this one, you know, and I never swallowed a goldfish. My brother-in-law did, and I gladly sat there and watched him do it, and I helped get enough kids there to make sure he did, but I wasn't going to swallow one. But you know, it almost, unfortunately, it became a competition, you know. You go to preachers' meetings. Well, how many are you running? You know, that's all they want to know. I never been to any, but I heard there was some that you had to wear a name badge and it had the number of how many you had in Sunday school. Like it's some kind of competition. It's not a competition. I have one race. It's my race. And listen, I have to run it, and it's whatever God intended for me. I have to run that race. I'm not in a competition with another brother or another preacher or another pastor. And listen, you shouldn't be in competition with someone else either. You just run the race that God set before you. Your race. Your race. Now, you say, how can I run it? I mean, we're leaving the throne room, of course. How are we going to run this race? He says, well, lay that weight aside. Well, I'm going to lay that weight. Every time God shows me something that maybe is hindering me, is it a weight or is it a wing? And I guess that's how we should look at something in our life. Is this thing causing us to keep us from moving, or is this thing helping us move? We got to lay that aside, well, that sin of unbelief. We have to lay that aside, or we ain't going anywhere. We lay it aside. Now, we're going to run with patience the race that is set before us. But how do we accomplish that? Only one way. Here is the verse. Here is the verse of verses in the Bible. Look in verse 2. Here it is. What's the Christian life? You want to know what it is in a nutshell? Here it is. Looking unto Jesus. That's it. Not looking to one another. Not looking at anybody else, not looking at self, not looking at the world, looking unto Jesus. Why? Because he's the author and he's the finisher of our faith. Who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. So what is he saying? How can I run this race? Why? Look to Jesus because, see, he's the author of your race. He's the finisher of your race. He's already endured. He knows every curve that you're going to take. And you know, it's things that we wouldn't choose for ourselves. I don't know, in the past two or three weeks, I've talked to several different people, and they've just shared things with me. You know, heavy burdens that they've had their entire life, some of them. And I think to myself, you know, in my own carnality, excuse me, but I think to myself, why would God allow that to happen to them? Why would God allow anybody to lose a child? You know? We're supposed to go before children. This dear one that is thinking about, you know, their child right now don't know which way it's going to go. I don't know. In my natural state, I do question why. Who wouldn't? And I would not choose that race for me. Would you? No, you wouldn't. If I chose a race, there'd be absolutely no heels. And it would be straight. And there'd be a nice breeze blowing. And it would be paved. It would be nice. And I'd have a motorized bicycle. That's if I was choosing it, I'd want every luxury and every easy thing I could get. But I don't get to choose my race. God chooses it. And you think, how can people deal with that? Well, listen, and listen, the people I've talked to and they've shared their burdens, you know how they dealt with it and how they're dealing with it now? Verse 2, looking unto Jesus. That's it. He's the author. He's the finisher. He knows. He knew that was going to happen in your life. He knew that. Because he had already been through. He had already went through. And another place says that he's the captain of our salvation. You know what that word captain means? It means one who goes before. He's already been. He's done been there. He's been through it. And listen, he knows what's around the corner. He knows what our race contains. He understands. That's why if we're going to run it, we got to keep our eyes on him. Simply on him. I read the story this week of a violinist. It did not give his name, but it said that he was a world-known violinist, and he was given a concert in Chicago. After he finished the concert, he played his last song. The people, it was a packed auditorium. They all stood and began to clap and gave him a standing ovation. They clapped to the point that he had to give an encore, and he played again. After he played, they stood up, gave him a standing ovation, and they clapped again. He did that six times. And the last time, they all stood and gave him a standing ovation, and they clapped, and he finally walked off the stage and went in the back. They interviewed him. And they said, we're just curious. Said, why did you give so many encores to your concert? They said, everybody was standing. I mean, that first time and clap. Why did you keep going on and on? He said, because everybody was standing but one person. And he said, it wasn't until that very last time that person stood up. And he said, that was the man that taught me everything I know about playing the violin. And he said, I wasn't going to stop until I seen him stand to his feet. So what he's saying, he had his eyes not on everybody clapping. He had his eyes on one person, that man that taught him how to play the violin. Listen, we're going to run this race, the Christian life. And listen, there's going to be people applaud you. There's going to be people clap. And if you're not careful, pride will get up in your heart. I remember just as a young preacher, the first church I took, and my father-in-law, he's one that got me in the church. He told me, he said, now listen, he said, those that are patting you on the back and telling you what a great message that is, he said, I'm going to tell you right now. He said, some of them are just looking for a place to stick the knife. I'll never forget that. Because, you know, I was prideful as a young preacher, and you ought to hear what they're saying about me, you know. He had to take me down a few notches, you know, and humble me. You know, we got to keep humble. And the only way you can do that is you just got to keep your eyes on Jesus. Yeah. You got to keep your eyes on him. We're to please one. That's our master. The one that owns us. The one who gave himself for us. And so as we're running our race, this Christian life, as we lay aside every weight, as we lay aside that sin of unbelief, and we run our race with patience, let's make sure we keep our eyes on the one who knows the path, on the one who's went before us. And listen, that's how we'll live the Christian life. That's how we'll run our race. You will not be hindered if you keep your eyes on him. When you take your eyes off him, that's when trouble becomes. Remember Peter, when he stepped out of the boat? You know, Jesus told him, you know, Peter said, let me come out there, if that's you, Lord. And he bid him, said, come on, Peter. You know, and Peter walks out on the water. I don't know how far he got. People criticize Peter, but he still holds the record. He still holds a record for a man walking on water. Yeah. There ain't nobody been able to do what Peter did. And Peter got out there, but what did it say? The wind come up, and he got his eyes off the Lord Jesus. And when he got his eyes off the Lord Jesus, he began to sink. Listen, as long as we keep our eyes on him, we'll be fine. You say, well, all this is going... Listen, no, you just keep your eyes on him. You don't look at the wind. You don't look at the waves. You don't look at all that stuff. You just keep your eyes on him, and you run with patience the race that he has set before you. Would you bow with me in prayer? Father, we thank you for your word. Oh, Lord, all of us, I think all of us tonight want to run that race. That's why we're here. Lord, we're trying to do what we can to serve Thee. But Lord, I pray, Father, we would always just keep our eyes on Thee, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. Help us, Father, as You point out weights in our lives, as we see hindrances, Lord, I pray that we would have the faith and the courage to lay those things aside, Father. Lay them aside. And Lord, that sin of unbelief, Father, help us to put it away. Help us to just trust You and believe You for great things. And Lord, I pray that we'd run our race. Lord, sometimes we look out and we can't see. It's dark. We don't know what's around the next bend. But God, I pray we'd just keep our eyes on You. And Lord, that You'd just lead us on through. Now, Father, bless Your people tonight. Lord, we're so thankful and grateful that they've come out. Lord, I know they're busy. I know they're tired. But Father, I pray that something's been said tonight through Your word that's been an encouragement, been a help, and been a blessing to them. Father, we love You. Be with us the rest of this week. We do pray again for the youth and the leaders as they head out on Friday. We pray, Father, You give them a wonderful time, a safe time. And Lord, we just pray that we hear good things. And Lord, that You'd bring us all back on Sunday. Lord, as we looking forward to another great Sunday, as we emphasize more of our life groups, and just pray, Father, You meet with us in a special way. We love You. We ask all these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. God bless you tonight. Appreciate you coming.